Hello everyone, welcome to Kentucky. Today is kind of cold here, but I want to show you a vehicle which you most likely have never seen before. May have been seen it on East German television or somewhere, but not in the United States. This vehicle was made as a small transport vehicle to answer the needs of small businesses, which were pretty much non-existent in East Germany. But government agencies and other agencies had that. So let's see, where is that? Well, first of all, it's not this one, because this is a 1956 Buick. We'll showcase this another time. But behind the Buick in this barn, that's where it lives. The mighty Barkas B1000. Well, let's try to get it out. In order to do that, first we need to start the Buick. This Buick's name is Betsy. And let's see if Betsy gonna start for us. Well, Betsy won't start. Maybe. Ooh, Betsy started. Awesome. Since you guys can hear the stereo sound coming from the exhaust, Betsy started. Let's see if Betsy would move. Well, maybe. It's kind of cold today, so it's not exactly easy. All right. So Betsy is alive and she came out for us. Great. So let's go and get the Barkas out of this barn. This used to be a tobacco barn where they were growing, where they were drying tobaccos. But now it just doubles as a car barn. So here's that beauty. Let's see how the Barkas starts. A very different ball game than the Buick. We got to add a little choke. And let's see. Nope. Wow, she's alive. Can you hear this awkward sound? I love it. And she smokes. The reason for that, because this car is a two-stroke vehicle. Sorry, this van, not a car. It's got a three-cylinder two-stroke engine. That was a big deal in East Germany. For some reason, they choose to use two-stroke engines. That's where it is. At the middle of the two seat, you can see the three cylinders. They each have its own coil. It's very similar to a Wartburg engine, but not quite. All right, we smoked off the area pretty good. So as you can see, this vehicle is a front engine, front wheel drive car, sorry, van. And unlike a Volkswagen, it has a lot of space in the back. It's got a similar property, it's like a Volkswagen. And you can see this is like a really nice door in the back. So once you open this, there's all kind of space here. You can put your motorcycle in, what I usually do. Or you can put a engine in it from the side, what I just did. So you can open the side. Little dog is very interested to go in. Are we going somewhere? Are we going? No, we're not going anywhere. So it's really easy to put the engine lift underneath and then just put something in here. And by the way, I have seats for it too, so I can double it as a minibus. Or I can actually sleep in here if I would put like some sort of carpet or some sort of bedding down here. Although no air conditioning. Well, actually I was wrong, there is air conditioning. Let's see. So when you open the door up here, you can start turning this one up. And then as you turn this up, that opens up a little hatch on the top. And that's the air conditioner. And it actually comes in on the side and starts blowing inside. It's quite useful at summertime. Also got Homer Simpson. It's not exactly East German. And we got the sliding windows. Like if you want to open the window, you just slide it. It's very basic and nothing fancy about that. It's got a very complicated front hub. I happen to have a picture of that front hub. Let's go look at it. Just last summer, I was in East Germany and I found this poster, which was made by the company. There's the Barkas sign you can see up there. And this is the front hub. It's very odd. You can see the hubcap. This is the older version. And it's independent suspension with a torsion spring in it. So if you look at this over here, this is the torsion spring inside. And all four wheels have independent suspension. We're going to put it up on the jack and I'm going to show it to you how it looks like. And this shows you the front hub assembly with the brakes and everything. It's got a lower pin in it and an upper pin in it. This is the drive shaft because it's a front wheel drive. And it's very complicated endeavor to adjust the hub. You can see the two bearings, the two hub bearings, and the way you adjust them is by moving there is a pin what actually moves them. So you're not using that big knot to tie up the bearings. You actually have to set up the bearings with those two other knots what's on that hub. So the big knots, you kind of push that little pin, and then that's going to push the inserts of the bearings, and that's how you set up how much the hub should move, not with the big knot. The big knot is just there, and then it just secures the whole assembly, but it has nothing to do with setting up the bearings like on any normal car humans invented in the past. The problem with these pins is like it's really hard to get out. So the way you get one of these out is you got to remove the grease fitting. You put a tool in there, and with that tool, the outside of the tool is here, the middle is here, and then you start extracting this whole thing up. You got to take this cover off, or that little piece here was actually holds it in position. So once you took that off, you can pull it out. The problem is that this thing is pretty much exposed to the elements, and they always rotten up. So it's always rust inside here and inside here. This is the arm. These are the arms. And then when you pull it out, it's really, really hard to pull this out because it's usually rotten inside here. So mine is are coming by hand by now because I removed them a couple times and greased it off and I put it back in. These ones actually ball bearings also, like flat bar bearings, roller bearings, I would say. And also there's like other roller bearings here. So the only reason you need to remove that, if you need to take the transmission out, or you want to take this drive shaft out. Otherwise, you don't need to touch it. These brake cylinders are very funny too, because they were exposed to the elements as well. They don't have the rubber cap on it, just a metal cap. And then they also like to rust up. So in this Barkas, he's like basically very temperamental. So when you step on the brake, you don't know it's going to pull to the left or pull to the right, or it's actually going to go straight, which is very oddly rare to go straight if you step on the brakes. But you can see it says Barkas Werke Karl Marx Stadt. So Karl Marx Stadt, now it's called Chemnitz. So actually for a very long time it was called Chemnitz, but the in the communist era, they renamed it Karl Marx Stadt, and there is a huge head there, and it's still there. I just been there in Chemnitz this summer, and we still we've seen that big Karl Marx head there, the home of the Barkas, actually. The winter time in Germany is comparable to Minnesota. It's really, really cold, but at least it's very windy. So therefore, they developed a heating device, which was living on the side over here, which was actually gas operated. So the actual gas from the fuel pump went over there, and we call that the Scirocco heating. So it's had a little electric fan, and the fan was blowing the flame, and then it was actually pretty effective until the fuel hose started to leak, and the whole thing went up in flames, and the whole vehicle blew up. So for safety reasons, it's not in there anymore. About the license plates on this car in Germany, in East Germany also, the license plate resembled the place where the license plate was issued. This particular one was issued in Leipzig, which actually accidentally today, now it's a big international cargo hub. So out of Cincinnati, there's a lot of big cargo airplanes actually going to Leipzig, the ex-East German town, and this license plate is from there. This is the incorrect validation sticker. I didn't have an extra one, so it's just the regular East German sticker on it. But on the back, every vehicle was required in Europe to show which country you're from. This vehicle was equipped with the DDR sign. DDR, which stands for Deutsche Demokratische Republik. Always these communist countries, they have these super long names for whatever reason. But in Germany, like the West German side, they didn't have the front D and the last D. So they just had the D only, and that was Deutschland or Germany. But also, again, you know, communist side, they have to have some really long names for these. So it was the Deutsche Demokratische Republik. And that was a requirement to be on. There's another sticker which you might like. It's from Route 66. This vehicle actually been there before. That's the big bunny, and it's like a tourist trap. I really like it. That's a little store at the middle of nowhere next to Route 66. Inside the vehicle, you guys can see the pressure tank down there, and then you can see the windshield washer, a radio, which is an aftermarket radio, the ashtray, because everybody was smoking at that time, and then the shifter is over here. It's very odd. So it's the H pattern is still existing, but it goes behind the driver, and then the reverse is like you got to push it through and then down. So when you push it into fourth gear, the person next to you will think you're getting frisky with her, because it's very close. Also, the spare tire is behind the passenger seat, and the battery is behind the driver's seat. When you turn on the engine, you can see it's like, well, this car is from the 80s, so it's got all this modern LED stuff. So this one here is a flow meter, which is disconnected because most of the time it's broken. Then you got a temperature gauge and a fuel gauge, which is quite accurate. And of course, this runs on mixed fuel. Mixed fuel is being mixed. Basically, I put the oil in and then put the gas on top of it. So back then in Germany, you were able to buy mixed fuel, which was at the pump, just like at some boat docks or something. And most of the cars were running on two-stroke. So two-stroke fuel. So there are still two gas stations last summer where they were selling mixed fuel in East Germany, which is non-existing anymore because it's all just Germany. But in my head, it's like there is the East part and the West part, and they both significantly different in the way the population thinks, and then the, what kind of cars they're driving and everything. So that East German regime left its mark on that place for sure. So you can see the speedometer is in kilometer per hour. This is the light switch. You can just twist it and turn it. And then there are several other switches here And then you got the mirror, and you can adjust that mirror to be nighttime or daytime mirror. And you can see how much space you got in the back here. I really like that function. And even though it's like a sort of like in a classic car category in my head, I still can use it as a utilitarian vehicle. Well, let's go put it on the lift and see what's underneath. So as you can see, we got it up on the lift. And I want to show you from underneath how this one of these Barkas look like. It's got a very interesting construction. You can see it's the front wheel drive there, independent suspension. And like I showed it to you on that paper, there's the torsion spring inside. And you can see it has an alternator, the bottom of the two-stroke engine. That's how you adjust points. The points are under this cover here. And when you take it off, you got three different points, and it's very complicated to adjust. I think I'm just gonna get it off and show it to you in a second. There are three points and three condensers, and the whole base plate can be turned, and then each of these points are sitting on the next plate. So there's some adjusting screws on it, which you can adjust. And then you got a tool on the top where you have to measure the top dead center of each piston, and then put a little light on it and see when the points actually touches. And you have to preset the pre-ignition correctly. So you got to have the proper value set based on how far that piston travels up. And there is no advance, like a vacuum advance or a centrifugal advance or anything like that. Basically what you do is you set it up here as a permanent way and just leave it at that and it runs. So we got three coils, three points. So practically we can say that we got three individual one cylinder engines in one housing. The parking brake actually actuates the front wheels. So if you have two big fat guys like me and my friend sit in it, if you really pull the parking brake, you probably can make the whole thing tip on its nose if the backside is empty. And there's like a frame. This is not exactly a frame in a conventional manner because it's a unibody construction, but there is a nice big spine in the middle here all the way to the end. And that's what holds the weight of the car, and the suspension ends up in being here. You can see the torsion springs in the back and the independent suspension also in the back, and there is no parking brake going there. It's only in the front wheels. And there's a little device here that makes a little clicking noise sometimes for me. This is actually a brake pressure regulator for the rear axle. So if you put a bunch of stuff on it, it will actually let more brake go to the back. If it's empty, then you have less brake pressure going to the back wheel, so it wouldn't start squealing when you're trying to step on the brake. So there is the brake pedal and the clutch pedal up here. You can see that. And the way you can drop the engine, it only takes about 30 minutes to take those bolts out there. And then this is the engine mount up here, and just let the engine down. And it takes very, very short time to, you don't need any kind of tools or engine hoist or anything. I talked to somebody in Europe who actually took these vehicles on tours. Like they put all the guitars and drums and basses and whatnot inside the car or the van. And they took two engines with them as a spare. So if, in case they break down, they're just gonna stop on the side of the road and change the engines. Actually, one time they had to do that. And then they just changed the engine and off they went. You can see the fuel pump on the side. The fuel pump is very interesting because it doesn't have a rod what goes into the engine. It actually just runs on air pressure. So the air pressure pushes as the crankshaft passes in front of a hole that creates a little air pressure, and that's what makes that membrane vibrate, and that's how it actually pulls up the fuel from underneath. But I replaced that with an electric pump because it's more reliable for us, my concern. So I got several other of these vehicles here. Let's see, I know about 12 of them in the US, and I got five of them here. I got five here, and I got a sixth one in Europe. So let's go check out the rest of my Barkas collection. They made several different configurations of Barkases. Oh, by the way, this is a rickshaw what I got from East India. I'm gonna install a jet engine on the back and then see how fast it's going. But that's gonna be another video. So here's one of the most, the rarest configuration is a wrecker truck. Actually, there is one more which was a sort of like a semi-truck looking thing. That's the least common. But this one, as I understand, they only made 50 of these. And I have one here. The Bug Eye Sprite race car is living on it right now. You guys can see how the original hubcaps looks like on a Barkas. And it's just like a cab, basically like a flatbed Barkas. If you see it inside, this looks very basic, just like the other ones. Well, it's too dark for that right now. But you can see the older version of the, they made little differences, little changes throughout the years. These are the old handlebars. The only thing they did, they changed it to a black fiberglass handlebar. This is the old sign. It says Barkas B1000. And then the bumper was a little bit changed. This one is the newer bumper on it. This truck is from the very last of the production. And then, well, we're gonna make another video of this whole thing once it's gonna be summer, because right now it's just cold and I wanna pull that out. But I have a couple more. Let's go see what else we find. So we are behind the barn. That's actually a Quack Arrow camper from East Germany with a Model T race car next to it and my daughter's 68 Beetle. But that's not why we're here. I keep three more Barkases here. So this first one is kind of wore out. It does have the original tires. That's how they look like. And it's really in poor condition, but it runs. So as you can see, this one is an older version. It has the license plate light. It's like a long bar instead of the two separate one, like on the newer versions. And then it has this window, which almost all of them had. And on the inside, it's in kind of in a poor condition, but I'll fix it later. You can see the dash. The dash is a metal dash all the way through. And it's got that steering wheel, whatever left of it. But this is how an older one, an older version looks like. And then the mirror, you can see the mirror. That's an older kind of mirror. You can see the newer mirror there. And this one is a panel version. This one came with the car holder, the record truck. And I just couldn't say no. So I just throw it up on the record truck. And I say, hey, I'm not going to leave a Barkas behind. So it's ended up here too. There's another difference too, as you see. This one has a radiator cap here, which you can put the coolant in. This one doesn't have one. They decided that it doesn't need one. So if you really need to fill up the coolant, you need to take the front grill off. And then there are several hoses that you got to use to fill them up. So these are my sort of non-working Barkases waiting for better days. And you guys might ask, where do I get parts for this thing? Well, in Europe. I went to old little moms and pop stores, and every time I came back from Europe, I bought new parts. I got a whole bunch of parts here for Trabants and Wartburgs and Barkases. I don't really want to sell anything, because then it was an incredible amount of effort, and not even the money, but the effort to bring all those here. And then you can't buy anything for this thing anymore, not even in Europe. So you can buy air freshener and fuel, but even the fuel has to be mixed. But while we're here, I want to see you an engine, a couple crankshaft here. You can see these are two Barkas crankshafts. Looks very similar to a Wartburg, except it's got a little bit thicker part here. These are about 50 horsepower crankshafts, and you can see there was some failure there. By the time I figure this out, how to how to break in one of these. So you can see there is like a hole in there. In the combustion chamber. So basically when it comes up and down, there's no valves involved, so it's definitely a two-stroke engine. There's ball bearings down here, ball bearings in the middle, and ball bearings down there too. So the way you can take that apart is that you need to force this crankshaft apart and then put them back together. It's not an easy thing. For the end, there is like the little seals. They like piston rings. It goes on the end. This is like a late model. Earlier versions had actual seal, which may or may not last too long.
And you can see that there's the engine block. It's a failed engine block, unfortunately, but I kept it. There's the bottom and there's this. So one time somebody rebuilt one for me, and then they had the crankshaft separate. So I had a crankshaft on the bottom part separate. That was 60 pounds, and had the engine block on its own. It was also 60 pounds. And my limit to check in luggage was 2 60-pound bags. So I was able to bring that engine back on the airplane, and I got a transmission there, but I think there's missing parts. So I'm trying to organize my parts right now. Not doing well. We just moved here not too long ago, so I still have to do some doing here before I can find everything. Well, that's it for the Barkas B1000. Thank you for watching, and see you guys next Friday. Bye.